16. It's time for yet another entry in the James Bond film series and talking about the cars that they used in it. This time we're talking about George Lazenby's only James Bond film, On Her Majesty's Secret Service. I'm terribly excited about this. I'm a huge fan of the Avengers, which means I love Diana Rigg. I love the Aston Martin DBS. And this might be one of the best films ever made. Is it? Well, we'll just have to see.
This never happened to the other fella.
What you've just seen is probably one of the best pieces of music I think ever composed for a title sequence in a film. On Her Majesty's Secret Service was directed by Peter Hunt. It was produced by Harry Saltzman and Albert R. Broccoli. And it was filmed from 1968 to 1969 and released at the end of 69. It stars George Lazenby as James Bond, Diana Rigg as Contessa Teresa di Vincenzo, Gabriele Ferzetti as Marc-Ange Draco, Telly Salvalas as Blofeld, IIse Steppat as Fräulein Bunt, George Baker as Sir Hilary Bray, and of course Desmond, Llewellyn as Q, Lois Maxwell as Moneypenny, and Bernard Lee as M. The filming locations for On Her Majesty's Secret Service are Marlow in Buckinghamshire, or Henley, I can't remember which one it is, it's somewhere in that area. Switzerland, Portugal, and a few other bits elsewhere too. It is certainly not a good acting performance from George Lazenby. I think he it isn't really someone you can compare directly to people like Roger Moore or Sean Connery. He didn't have the acting experience of this time. He really only had done a little bit of modelling and very light acting work. But the rest of the film is superb. Absolutely fantastic soundtrack by the incomparable John Barry. Wonderful direction by Peter Hunt. Marvellous, marvellous cinematography. Editing by John Glenn, who took over from Peter Hunt, who'd been the editor on the Bond series for quite a number of years at this point. Beautiful scenery, amazing car chase. Soundtrack's one of my favourite film soundtracks of all time. Just absolutely amazing in every way. What we're going to do now is take a look at some of the cars used in London and Magic Secret Service. There actually aren't that many, which is surprising, considering I'm a huge lover of cars and usually love James Bond, but I still love this film, and let's see if these 10 or 11 cars that are used in the series, or rather, in some cases, multiples of the same car, are any good, and whether the film should be considered to be a masterpiece of cinema that those people say that it is. So I apologise about the lighting that's in the car at the moment. There's not a lot I can do about it. The camera's trying its best to sort it out. Anyway, we've got the first four cars from one of the Majesty Secret Service. The one that's used the most is probably the 1969 Mercury Cougar XR7, which is driven by Diana Rigg. It's not really as good a fit for her as a car as the Lotus Elan and the Avengers, I don't think. I don't think it quite suits her as well as the Lotus. The Lotus was perfect. This is a very much heavier car, much bigger car, probably to do with the fact that Ford have always quite liked putting their mark on the Bond films. You see that in films like Goldfinger and Diamonds Are Forever and Die Another Day. This particular XR7 was a car that had the 428 cubic inch engine option with the ram air hood scoop on it. There were three different Cougars used in Honor of Magic Secret Service. One of them got destroyed, which, if you watch the stock car racing sequence, you'll kind of see why that was the case. One of them actually came up for sale in California, I believe, a few years ago. I did actually see one of the cars, I don't know if it's that one or another one, because at least two of them do survive, at the James Bond in Motion exhibition in Covent Garden a few years ago. The car that I saw wasn't pristine at all. It did have a lot of kind of little scratches in it and maybe even some small dents. It wasn't as dented as the car would have been after the stock car sequence, but it wasn't perfect. The panel gaps were quite bad on it. It was good to see a car in that sort of condition as opposed to, you know, gleaming and shiny, which is what some of them are when you see them in museums like that. The car, apparently, according to some research I've done, which I don't know if it's true or not, was prepared for the film by Carroll Shelby, or rather the three that they used were prepared by Carroll Shelby. I can't confirm or deny that because I don't know that to be the case, but I just thought it was an interesting thing to read about. So I'll leave that in place. So that's the Mercury Cougar that gets used in a lot of different sequences, both in Portugal and Switzerland. You see it an awful lot. The next car is probably my favourite car on the Majesty Secret Service, a 1968 Aston Martin DBS Vantage. Gunmetal grey, GKX 8G. GKX for Buckinghamshire plate, because the Aston Martin factory at the time was in the process of moving from Feltham to Newport Pagnell. And again, that's why BMT 216A is a plate that's local to Feltham. That's for car from Goldfinger and Thunderball and other films. This particular car was not entirely standard. It was kind of halfway between a standard DBS, which is a six-cylinder engine, and the Vantage spec cars, which are a bit more tuned. At this time, the V8 car hadn't come out. You could see a V8 style car in Persuaders, which was only a year later than On Her Majesty Says That started filming in about June 1970. So it's a DBS again, so very Bondian type of car. I think this car looks wonderful. It's a very underrated Bond car. You don't see many people having this in their top 10 list of Bond cars, but it's certainly right near the top for me. Absolutely fantastic car with the wire wheels and everything. Not many gadgets in it apart from a sort of cutout and a glove box for a rifle. Next car we saw in London Magic Secret Service, and again, it's used quite a lot. It's a 1968 Rolls-Royce Silver Shadow drophead coupe by Melinda Park Ward. That's used by Gabriele Ferzetti. I think it's his surname. I don't get it wrong. As the head of the Union Corse, the sort of Corsican national crime syndicate that he represents. This car is a beautiful, I think it's a left-hand drive one as far as I remember. That's used in the filming in Portugal and also in Switzerland. The spaciousness of the Shadow is quite handy because they have five men in it at one stage. It's not my favourite car. I think Rolls-Royce is, personally for me, always a bit ostentatious. I prefer Bentleys if I have a choice, but there we go. The main villain car used in London Magic Secret Service is a 1963 Mercedes-Benz 220S in black. Bond films for ever so long have had black Mercedes as the main villain cars, or sort of this grey one. We could talk about Goldfinger, we could talk about Octopussy, we could talk about innumerable cars where you see a Mercedes used as a Bond villain car, and there's another one as well. This is the one where they have the main car chase of the film, where the Mercury Hugo is chased by the Mercedes through the snowy, dark mountains of Switzerland, and some amazing driving. I don't know how many cars they actually used in the sequence, probably several of them, because they do blow the Mercedes up when it gets to the stock car sequence, and it's just such spectacular action sequences in this film, just absolutely wonderful. So talking of the stock car racing sequence, which had a separate director from Peter Hunt in the film, a chap called Anthony Squires, this was filmed on a frozen runway in the mountains with water and snow sort of sprayed onto it to keep the track in ideal filming condition. It must have taken days to film it, and it's a brilliant, brilliant sequence. It's actually just part of a longer chase. But Diana Rigg, she learned how to slide the car by driving a Ford Escort, and we'll get to that in a second. But it's just a very, very well done sequence, and you know, all practical effects, years and years before CGI. And it's just brilliant. I don't, you hear me say so many things about this film as to how much I like it, and I really do. I think it's an exceptionally well-made film in so many areas. Just, you know, thinking about the soundtrack, and actually at this stage with the car, there's no soundtrack in the stock car racing sequence at all. It's just the sound of the engines of the cars going around. The two main cars that are on the track, as well as the Mercedes and the Mercury Cougar, are two Austin Minis. I think they're 68 Austin Minis. The thumbnail that I showed just now, you would have seen the Mercedes ramming into the back one of the Minis, which looks incredibly dangerous. It probably was. And then they use a total of seven brand new Ford Escorts. The Ford Escort was released in 1968, so this sequence would have been filmed late 68, early 69, I think. and just a load of brand new cars. You actually see Timo Mäkinen at one particular point driving one of the cars because he was one of the drivers for the rally sequence, which isn't surprising, really. You know, you get the best drivers you can to perform stunts in a Bond film. So let's talk now about some of the other cars used separately from that sequence. One is a 1920s Mercedes, which is used right at the end of the film, just before Blofeld comes along in his Mercedes-Benz 600, which he drives. If you haven't seen the film, I don't really want to spoil it and tell you what happens when Blofeld comes along in his car. And actually, he's driving this time. But the car that he uses in Diamonds Are Forever is actually the same type of car, which is interesting. Excuse me. So, 1964 Mercedes-Benz 600, after this sort of 20s Mercedes comes along. People have tried to identify the type of Mercedes that is for years, and they've not been successful yet. So, if you obviously know, then let me know myself. Another Mercedes used on the United Secret Service is a 1969 0309 bus, which you see to transport the girls in Blofeld's clinic away for Christmas holidays. And the last car is used by Bernard Horsfall, who was a very famous actor on television in the 60s, and he appeared in things like The Avengers multiple times. He is the sort of contact that Bond has in Switzerland, who's just observing him and tries to get close to the clinic at one stage and gets rather brutally murdered. Very nice. But he has a 1969 Volkswagen 1300, a Beetle. I thought it was an older Beetle, actually, but when you look at the photographs, you can see it's got the sort of square-on headlamps as opposed to the ones which fold back into the wings, which are the older Beetles. And it has the fuel filler flap in a particular place, whereas older Volkswagen, sometimes you have to lift the front bonnet to put the fuel in. So you can tell it's a 69 Volkswagen 1300. I hope you appreciate the upgraded quality of the screen grabs that I found for this film, because it's a James Bond film and not some old TV series, it looks a lot better on the resources that I found online. So there we are then. The cars of On Her Majesty's Secret Service. Is this film worth watching in 2020? I don't think I really need to go into more about that than I did at the beginning of this video. Apart from George Lazenby's acting performance and the way he doesn't really nail the character particularly well with the sort of humorous sequences and just general dialogue and things like that, the film is fantastic. He's actually himself quite convincing in the love sequences. There's a couple of those, particularly the last one at the end of the film. He's very, very good at the action. And it's not hard to see why the producers actually offered him £1 million to sign for a few more films. I think it was five or six more films he was supposed to make with them. And they were going to offer him the signing bonus with the contract. And he turned it down on the advice of his agent, who was probably the worst agent you could ever imagine, because he said, oh, spy films will be gone, and you didn't particularly enjoy it anyway, did you, George? You know, you didn't enjoy it very much, and you wore a beard to the premiere and everything, and just don't worry about it, we'll find you something else to do. And he then made one of the weirdest films I've ever seen in 1971 called Universal Soldier, not one Jean-Claude Van Damme, it's the other one. And I wouldn't say that was very good for his career, because he really missed out. He could have got a lot better in terms of the dialogue and the humour. He could have improved, I'm sure, but that's what he decided to do, and he only made one film. And for his first film performance, I know he tricked the producers into giving him the role. He did all right. The rest of the people, obviously, he made this one on top of their game. And it could be the best Bond film that was ever made. I don't really want to make statements like that. We'll have to see when we look at some other ones. But thank you ever so much indeed once again for watching. Don't know if I see a difference or not. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel for more interesting videos with poor lighting. If you haven't already done so, please don't forget to like this video, leave a comment below, maybe suggest the next Bond films that I cover. I want to do some more Roger Moore ones, and there's a lot of those, so maybe suggest the order you want me to cover those in, but I've already done Live and Let Die, so I'm not doing that one again. Visit my Facebook page, facebook.com/LloydVeerConsulting, and indeed my Instagram page, instagram.com/Lloyd_vehicle_consulting. Thank you ever so much indeed for watching.